good to be here in the House of Wood this morning. Just want to welcome everybody. Thank you all so much for coming out. I want to welcome everybody to Facebook as well. If y'all are willing to join us, you can of all his wondrous works. Glory ye in his holy name, and let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. It says, seek the Lord and his strength, and seek his face forevermore. Remember his marvelous works that he has done, his wonders and his judgments of his mouth. So as we've come in today on this Sabbath, we've come to pause from everything. You know, you think about our society today, we're always busy, busy, go, go, go. But we take the time out on a Sunday to just slow down a little bit, to reflect on what Jesus has done for us. And I hope that whenever we reflect on that, that we just lift him up in song and we just give him all the praise and all the glory and for everything that he's done. Let's go ahead and go to him in prayer this morning. Lord, we do thank you for this opportunity that we have together in your house. Father, I just worship you for everything that you've done for me. And God, even if you wouldn't do anything else, God, you're still worthy of all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. Lord, I thank you that we can come in this house today and fellowship with other believers, but most importantly, that we can come in this house today and lift you up to magnify you. And I know that your word says that if you would be lifted up, that you would draw all men unto you. God, let Adoration Church be a church that is adoring you. Let Adoration Church be a church that is praising you and giving you all the honor and all the glory and just standing back and just watching you do a miraculous work. God, I do pray for Pastor Bear this morning as he brings the message. We just pray your hand of anointing to be upon him, upon the word that he's going to share this morning. God, I do pray for the new members that we're going to be receiving, just that you would be with them as they come into this fellowship of this church. God, I just thank you for them, and God, pray that you would bless them. And Father, I do just pray that everything that we do in this house would glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. Oh, I took back what he stole from me. Took back what he stole from me. Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet, he's under my feet, he's under my feet, he's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. Well, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. Oh, I took back what he stole from me. Oh, took back what he stole from me. I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet, he's under my feet, he's under my feet, he's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. I can't believe what the Lord has done. Believe what the Lord has done in me. He saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around, set my feet upon the solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? He saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around, set my feet upon the solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body, he touched my mind,
He saved me. It was just in time. Oh, I'm gonna praise His name. Each day He's just the same. Come on and praise Him. Look what the Lord has done.
Look what the Lord has done.
Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me. It was just in time. Oh, I'm gonna praise His name. Each day He's just the same. Come on and praise Him. Look what the Lord has done.
Let's do it again. One more time. Look what the Lord has done. Has He done anything for you this morning?
Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me. It was just in time. Oh, I'm gonna praise His name. Each day He's just the same.
Hallelujah.
Come on and praise Him. Look what the Lord has done.
Amen. Has He done something good for you this morning? Hallelujah.
God, I praise You. Hallelujah.
Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, He is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Strength is in Your name, for You alone can save. You will deliver me. Yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, He is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in Your hands. I'm holding on to Your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in Your hand. I'm holding on to Your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always
the one who reigns forever. He is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
There's nothing to fear now, for I'm safe with you. So when I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, belongs to you. The power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Against the power of our God, you shine in the
Praise God.
The battle does not belong to us. Have you been going through a battle?
Amen.
Anybody been dealing with any battles? Am I the only one that's dealt with any battles? Can you hear me out there? Yeah, we all go through spiritual battles. If you're on God's side, there's someone who's opposing us. Amen? Amen. And if God is for us, then who can be against us? That's right. That's right. So thank God for the victory that we already have. We just need to hold on to it, claim it, hold with our faith and believe no matter what you're going through. God is with you and he's fighting for you. Amen. Can you give him another hand clap of praise today? Praise God. Praise God. Well, this morning is the first Sunday of the month. We have communion on the first Sunday. And we want to continue to worship the Lord right now. And if you will, you've got your little cup and wafer here. And if you'll just start to prepare. But as we prepare physically for the opening of this, we prepare spiritually and open our hearts and open ourselves before the Lord today. Jesus said to do this in remembrance of me. And when we think about what he has done for us, his body that was broken on a cross, his blood that was shed for the remission of our sins, and he did that for you and for me, for all, for whosoever will, for whosoever will. What a blessing. So we want to take a moment right now, and we want to just take a moment of personal prayer, of just inspecting ourselves. Let the Holy Spirit go and go into every corner and every area of our lives. And if there be anything there, if there be any resentment, if there be any unforgiveness, if there be any bitterness, if there be any jealousy, if there be any strife, if there be anything, if there be any greed, if there be anything, search our hearts, Lord. Go deep inside of us. Cleanse us today. Will you take time right now for just a personal prayer, and then we'll pray together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Search our hearts. Purify us, God. Cleanse us with your blood. Wash us and make us clean, Lord. God, forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of the ones that we've committed by maybe knowing what we were doing. And forgive us for the ones that we've committed by not knowing that we were even doing it. Lord, for times that we've neglected to do things that we should have done, when we should have done good and we didn't do it, Lord, your word says that is sin. And Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit, and we just sense your presence in this place right now, to just search our hearts and cleanse us and prepare us, Lord. For we're not only preparing for this day and this feast and eating and communing together with you and with one another, but we're looking and preparing ourselves for that day when we'll be around your table and we'll be eating and we'll be worshiping together with all the believers, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Lord, help us to be ready. In Jesus' name, amen. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, it says, "And when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not eat more any more thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you, personally. This do in remembrance of me. If you will, take and let's eat the bread. Thank you, Lord. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. If you will, let's drink together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Can you just now just praise him and thank him? Thank you, Lord.
Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
He's the name above all names.
Cause you're the name above all.
Of all names,
cause you're the name above all names, and you're worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing
how great is our God. He's great. Sorry. He's great and greatly to be praised. Amen. Amen. He deserves all the glory and all the honor. Praise his holy name. Praise his holy name. You can be seated today. It's good to see all of you in the Lord's house and our guests today. We welcome each of you and just thankful for you to being here today. And friend of ours from a friend of mine and a bank friend from Atlanta, Tom and his wife Kathy, are with us this morning, and they live in Atlanta and are in town this weekend, and they said, I asked them to come, and they came. So we're glad to have them with us, and all of you, and I look forward to meeting some others that are here today that I haven't really personally yet met, but we're just thankful for each of you, Sister Brenda Vires, for her being with us too, and we're honored to have Pastor Bear and Layla with us again today as they are going to bring forth. He's going to bring forth the word of God, and she's going to bring forth the word in some way. And she's looking at me like, what? But before we do that, we have something also another exciting thing that's taking place here in the church. And that is the receiving new members into the congregation. And it's a time of just coming and opening the door, basically. It's not that the doors are not open for anybody and everybody, but it's a matter of people making a commitment and saying, I'm going to choose to worship with you and serve with you, and we're going to be here with you. And it doesn't save you. It doesn't do anything as far as salvation goes, but it does make a statement and a declaration of commitment and faithfulness. And it sends a message out to the rest of the church, we are with you and we love you. And from the church, we send a message back saying, we are with you, and we love you. Amen? Amen. So if you have attended the membership class that I had couple Sundays ago, and maybe you've attended one a long time ago and have not joined. If you will come, we want you to stand up here in front. So if you'll come up here and stand in front of the podium here. And look what the Lord is doing. Amen. I'm going to come down there with you all in just a moment, but I want to share something as far as what we as the Church of God, what our beliefs are, a declaration of faith, and maybe some don't know and maybe are considering to join the church, but we just want to remind us also as we are members and different ones that of what we believe in. And this is scriptural. These are based upon God's word. There's no man-made ideas or man-made theology or anything, but it's the word of God. We believe in the verbal inspiration of the Bible. We believe in one God eternally existing in three persons, namely the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. We believe that Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of the Father, conceived of the Holy Ghost and born of the Virgin Mary, that Jesus was crucified, buried, and raised from the dead, that he ascended to heaven and is today at the right hand of the Father as the intercessor. We believe that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that repentance is commanded of God for all and necessary for forgiveness of sin. We believe that justification, regeneration, and the new birth are wrought in by faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. We believe in sanctification subsequent to the new birth through faith in the blood of Christ, through the Word and by the Holy Ghost. We believe in holiness to be God's standard of living for His people. We believe in the baptism with the Holy Ghost subsequent to a clean heart. We believe in speaking with other tongues as the Spirit gives utterance and that it's the initial evidence of the baptism in the Holy Ghost. We believe in water baptism by immersion, and all who repent should be baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. We believe in divine healing. It's provided for all in the atonement. We believe in the Lord's Supper and the washing of the saints' feet. We believe in the premillennial coming, second coming of Jesus, first to resurrect the righteous dead and to catch away the living saints to him in the air, and second to reign on the earth 1,000 years. And we believe in the bodily resurrection, eternal life for the righteous, and eternal punishment for the wicked. All right, now I'm coming down here with you all. Anybody counted? I haven't counted. 12. Well, here are some disciples, aren't there? Praise God. Praise God. We're going to start out with the Stallard and Patton family here. Stallard, Jack, and Yvonne, and Tammy, and they came to us back in October, I think it was, of last year. And not only did they come here and start coming and attending the church, but they brought along a ministry that they had been doing of feeding the hungry. And so we have brought that into the church here, and now it's become a ministry of the church, an outreach, to reach out to people who are in need of food and hungry. And so we're just thankful for Jack and Yvonne and Tammy. Amen, aren't we? And I don't see the wheelchair still. It's at home, yeah. 2 weeks ago, she came in a wheelchair. We had prayer. She walked out, and she's been walking ever since. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. You all want to say anything? Do you all want to say anything?
Oh, I'm just happy to be here, and we love everybody here, and we love the church.
I'm glad to be here, too. We just hadn't been for John Spears over there, I guess, inviting us several times. We came in, and we just decided after hearing Todd preach, we just thought, well, this is what we need, and this is where we're at. Really enjoyed it, and we love everything. buddy. Here.
We just, when you come here, we feel like we're home. We haven't had that feeling in a very, very long time in a church. And here it is, like from my childhood. I just walk in. I feel good. When I walk out, I'm blessed even more.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Let me share one more thing about Jack and Yvonne. Y'all been married 62 years. Praise God. Praise God. And this is Sean and Miranda Ball. Is that what? Hall. Sorry. I messed up there, didn't I? Not the first time. Get used to that, okay? Sean and Miranda. Sean, I think you're 20? 21. And Miranda? 21 tomorrow. Oh, okay, well, happy birthday. Yeah. They moved here from over, well, he's originally from Bristol. And actually, let me tell you, want to tell the story about the concrete? Okay, I'll tell. We built this side of the building a couple years ago, and when we did, you know, all this concrete that's poured here, he had a part in it. His dad owns the concrete company, and he helped spread this concrete out through here. He took a day. Took a day off from school, right? We won't tell on that. But he came in and he came and helped build this church, and now the Lord has brought them here to this church, and they love. Yeah, that's right. And they love children, and they were working with children's ministries at the church that they were attending before. And a lady that I know from way back when I was in high school, and Melissa knows her too, is the children's ministry leader at their church. And they've been partnering and working with her. And they moved over this way, and they were like, well, we need to get connected to a church. So she told us, and we reached out, and they came in a few weeks ago. And actually, I think it was the first Sunday they were here, they came to the membership class that night. So they're ready. They're ready. So this is Sean and Miranda Hall. And this is Travis and Marie Widener. And Travis and Marie have been here a little over a year now and have gotten involved. You heard him sing just a few minutes ago, and he's playing the guitar up here and involved in praise and worship. But last year, around this time, the pandemic had struck, and right before that time, we had an interim youth minister who was here, and he was working. He lived over in Richlands, Virginia, and when the pandemic struck, he wasn't able to come back and forth, and then we just stopped the youth ministry because of everything that was going on. So back in the fall, I guess it was around November, I was thinking and praying, and I was like, I think it's time for us to start our youth ministry back. We need to get our youth back in here. We need to be ministering to our young people. So I'm like, well, I'm going to start it. I'm going to do something, whether, you know, we're going to get this going. And so we have an internal Facebook group called Prayer and Praise for prayer requests and praise reports and different things like that. And so I just sent out a message saying, would you help me to pray for someone to help us to lead our ministry, our youth ministry? And I was looking outside. I was looking in different places. And then Travis responded and said, I feel like that I would like to do something with the youth. And I'm like, all right, well, we'll get together and we'll talk some. So they are now leading our youth ministry on Wednesday nights, our teenagers. And Marie is involved with that, both of them, and they're doing a wonderful job. And we're just thankful for them. Did y'all want to say something?
Not really. Just, you know, God is good. And, you know, sometimes you have to put forth a step in pure faith to receive all the wonderful things that God has for you. And, you know, it's not that we've really given anything. We've received everything. So God is good.
Praise God. Would you like to say something? No. She says no. Leave that mic away from me. And this is Tim and Joyce Barker. And they started coming last summer, I think it was, or fall, around fall, summer. Is that right? Started coming some? Yeah, I think so. And I learned the other night, I didn't know this, that she was an associate pastor at a church. And so she preaches. And I'm like, well, we're going to have to get you to preach. So Joyce and Tim, and Tim, I think, is a retired post office mailman. And they live here in the Bristol area and have felt like this is where they want to put their roots down, and we're thankful for them. Would you all like to say something?
Thank you so much, everyone, for making us feel so welcome, like we belong. I think that's what everybody, our human needs is, we want to belong. We want to be a part of it. And not every church has that ability to make people feel like they belong. And I just want to thank you for making us feel that. It's been a really long time, and we appreciate it so very much.
Tim, you want to say anything? Tim learned to pick on the guitar. Just picked it up and started playing, isn't that right? Started learning in mandolin or dulcimer, and we're going to have a bluegrass Sunday one morning. We're going to have a bluegrass praise and worship. You hear that, Pastor Nathan? We're going to have a bluegrass Sunday, and we're going to get the banjo out, and we're going to get the fiddle and all kinds of stuff, right? So we're going to let people use their talents. You know, it's a matter. It's not about all a one-man show in church. It's about everybody doing everything that you're called to do and being a part of that. And it's so exciting because, you know, it's just exciting. And this is the Bowman family. So this is Tamara, and this is Brandon, and this is Bonham. And they have been here since around January. Is that right? Somewhere around that time frame, and they've been getting right in there, and she has a heart for children and doing children's ministry and working with the kids. And Brandon, he likes security and doing security things, and he has his HVAC company, so he's already been helping us with our HVAC and doing some things with that. And Bonham, he likes technology, and he's back there. He was this morning back there helping on the sound area. So they're already getting involved, right? So isn't that wonderful? Would you all like to say something?
I will, because I'm a speaker. We want to thank the church for making us feel welcome. Pastor Todd and Melissa, again, it's the same theme through the line here, that just a feeling of being needed and wanted, and we all feel that way, I believe. I believe the Lord has put that in us. We are branches from a very big tree. We all have gifts to use, and I'm excited. We're excited to be here to use those gifts. We're so proud of Bonham for being back there and thanking Brandon for adding him up there. And thank you to Lana and Ken. They're just precious saints of God. If you ever need anything prayer-wise, they are just precious people. But we're glad to be here, very blessed, very thankful to have all of these people up here with us. So.
Listen, it won't bite, I don't think. Well, we're thankful to have all of you, aren't we? Aren't we? All right. Well, as we've had in our class and what we've done before here when we take in new members is to speak about expectations. And one of the things that I ask for us to do is I want to just make it clear of what, as a member, what those expectations are. And then, as your church family, what they can expect from us, too. Because we're in this together. Amen? And so, as a member, the expectation will be that you support and further the mission of Adoration Church of God, that you will pray for your church and fellow members regularly, that you'll be present in worship and other church events on a regular basis, that you'll support your church with your spiritual and financial gifts, and that you'll find an area of ministry through which you can serve Christ and others. Do you agree with that? Yes, okay. Will you stand as a congregation? And as the church family, we commit this to you, that we will provide opportunities for you to live out your faith in service to others, that we will provide faith-building opportunities for you to grow as a Christian, that we will provide opportunities for you to develop deep and lasting friendships and community with others, that we will provide opportunities for lifelong learning as you deepen your understanding of the Bible and the Christian faith, and that we will be good stewards of your financial contributions to your church. And the congregation says, amen, amen. And lastly, we have a covenant of membership, so if you will just remain standing as I ask a few questions here and make a statement at first. You realize in presenting yourself for membership that you are assuming a solemn obligation, and it is expected that you will always be true to your promise and faithfully fulfill and discharge your obligation as a loyal member. Do you publicly confess and testify that you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior in the full pardon of your sins? Are you willing to walk in the light of the Scriptures as it shines upon your path? Are you willing to abide by and subscribe to the discipline of the Church of God as outlined by the Scriptures and as set forth in the minutes of the General Assembly? Are you willing to support the church with your attendance and temporal means to the best of your ability as the Lord prospers you? Do you agree to be subject to the counsel and admonition of those who are over you in the Lord? If there be any member who has a legal objection to any of these becoming a member of the church, the objector may now so state, and as I've said before, speak now or forever hold your peace, okay? Okay. By the authority vested in me as a member, ordained bishop of the Church of God, I do welcome you in as members of Adoration Church of God. Amen. Amen. We've come to know you, and we've come to love you, and we're here for you. And I want you to know, as your pastor, whatever we can do, Melissa and I and other the pastoral staff, and the whole congregation, if there's anything that you need, please do not ever hesitate to call upon us. We love you all. Let's have a word of prayer. If you will stretch your hand this way, we want to pray for each of these and just give thanks. Father, we do give thanks today for these 12 here that have joined and have made this commitment to join this local body, God, of the church here. God, that are bringing their gifts and their talents and bringing their love for you into this place. Lord, I pray, God, that you would bless them, and I pray, Lord, that you would bless the ministries that they do. Lord, give them favor. Let it increase. Let souls be saved. Let lives be changed. Let people's be discipled in you and grow in you. And Lord, I pray for your protective hand upon them, God, and watch over them, and just let them always be fulfilled in what they're doing, Lord. Let them always be filled with your peace and with your love and with your joy. And give them hope, and just bless them mightily. And we thank you, God, again for each of these. And Lord, I'm believing for even more that's going to be joining, and more that are coming in. And just thankful for what you're doing. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Thank you all. You can be seated. God bless you all. Thank God. Thank you all. God bless you. God. The song we sang very first is Look What the Lord Has Done. Amen. Look what the Lord has done. It's good to see you, Chris. Amen. Chris gave his heart to the Lord on Easter. He's back with us today. Thank God. Our sister Sally, she shared last week with us a testimony that she had cancer 3 different times. She had surgery last summer. She was taking chemotherapy. It developed blood clots in both of her lungs. She decided, I'm going to stop taking the chemotherapy. I'm going to trust the Lord. And she was trusting the Lord all along anyway. And she stopped doing it. So the doctor said, well, we're going to have to do periodic tests more frequently to do PET scans and everything. And she went for a PET scan a couple of weeks ago. And when she went for the PET scan, she said last week that she thought she would light up like a Christmas tree. But when they did the PET scan that day, there was nothing. Praise God. Clear, clean. Praise God. Praise God. It's an exciting time to be here a part of Adoration. And we're just thankful for each of you. And as the church is growing and as people keep coming in and just excited about what the Lord is up to. And we're honored today to have with us, and especially Melissa and I, our pastors, who have been mentors to us for many years. We met them around 22 years ago when Melissa and I first got married, and we went up to Charlottesville. We visited with them in Charlottesville and met with them after church that morning, and with Pastor Bear and one of the elders, and we were talking, God started dealing with our hearts, and just felt like that's where we were supposed to be, and we learned so much under them. We're still learning. I mean, I just kind of sit and listen. Whenever we're around them, when we've had opportunities, we met with a pastoral couple yesterday. We had them over to our house last night, and just the many stories and just the wisdom that they both share, and I love how that they pour into our kids, and not only them, but through this kid too. And we receive from that, and as they're doing a work now, it's a continuation of what the Lord started in them many years ago. It's just in a different light now. And instead of being behind the pulpit and speaking at one church all the time, they're going out and they're ministering in different ways and going and having lunch or dinner and meeting with pastors and their spouse throughout the country. And we were honored to have them here Easter weekend, and I had them to come up and greet us as a congregation. And afterwards, I told him, I said, I'd like to have you come and speak soon. And so he said, well, we're coming through in May to go to Tennessee. He had some things that they're doing in Tennessee. And so they're here with us this morning, and we're honored to have them with us. And so will you give them a good adoration, clap, a welcome today as they come and
You know what? I am so glad we're here on Membership Sunday and that you allowed them to testify and that we heard those testimonies. You know what? You could start a church with those 12 people that joined the church this morning. I mean, what God has done here is amazing. Yeah. But it's because of you being who you are that they felt welcome when they came and they wanted to stay. Several of them mentioned that. So your being who you are helps to bring people in. But, you know, I've always heard that a church eventually takes on the characteristics of the pastoral family. And I want to tell you, I see that in you. And it's amazing. It's beautiful. It's what God has done, that gentle, loving spirit of acceptance and encouragement that we see in this family and how they have raised their children or reared their children. I think you raise goats and rear children, I've been told. But anyway, sometimes you raise them. But it's beautiful. And I just love the spirit that we feel here. And you are, we love everything that we see. We love everything that we see that God has done. And we're so grateful. We're grateful for you that he didn't tell you. Right after their honeymoon, they spent the first two weeks in our home. So we have seen what they are from the beginning. And it's a couple that God wanted to use and has used mightily. And it's just been beautiful, the whole journey. And thank you for having us here again today. We love you all. God bless you.
Well, Layla, while you just stand there, your sanctuary, your facilities are really incredible what you've accomplished here. Your campus outside, your dreams for the future, you're just blessed. Your stage for growth. And I want to compliment you on that. I want to compliment you that you have a pastor's family. We finished 44 years of being lead pastor on August 30th of last year, and we left that week. We thought we'd leave that day, but it was actually 4 or 5 days later that we left. And we've traveled from Maine to San Antonio and Pennsylvania to Georgia in the last 8 months, right through COVID. We just kept on rolling, didn't slow down, and been in churches of numerous denominations, including the Church of God, of course. And it is such a privilege to be in a church that's so well kept, so beautiful, that we have seen it grow. We were here in the beginnings when you were just in the small sanctuary. And through the years, as God has blessed you and your leadership through the Asbury family, and to see their family grow up. It is just such a choice privilege to be here, isn't it?
Amen.
It is.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. So, I thank you very much. Now, in case you're wondering, part of my journey as a pastor was that, let me give you just a little quick history, and I'll be mindful of the time this morning, but I pastored in Whitfield for five years, 4 months, and it was all white, Caucasian. So the journey took us to Virginia Tech, both of us to work on our doctorates there, and we attended a church there that was a blended church, and we enjoyed it so much. And so we then made our journey to Charlottesville, and in Charlottesville, God opened doors for us, and we worked with refugees. And so at one point in time, we had seven services on a Sunday. Two were in English, and five were in different languages, and we had over 20 different tribes of refugees and people of different nations and colors. We really don't know how many. It was just like, you know, you say Burmese, but there were five different tribes of Burmese. And so the Lord blessed us so abundantly. And so we encourage people to wear something native to church. And so what transpired was that I would say, that's really, I love your shirt. And they would say, would you like one? I said, you bring it, I wear it. And so they gradually brought me clothes that most Sundays I wore something of different cultures. This is from Tanzania, and so you get a full look at it, okay? And so it warmed the hearts of people. It's the strangest thing, but people would come from countries where they would be strafed by airplanes, literally. I mean, enemy planes would just come in and bomb orphanages. And people that literally had fled through jungles and been separated from husband and wife by a miracle come back together in refugee camps. Literally, there are children here this morning, and I don't want to be graphic, but things they would do to women who were expecting was abominable, and they saw those terrors and those awful things, yet they loved their country. They loved their country in spite of what was done to them, and they still loved to sing the songs of their country, and they held on to their foods. And so we were privileged to share in getting to eat foods of around when we would have events. We would encourage people, bring foods like you make in your country. And it was like going around the world in one night. And so here in Southwest Virginia, as I look at you, and some of you probably came from West Virginia, and some of you perhaps from North Carolina, and you know, you have to ask, what are your native foods? And when you have your dinners, bring what's native to you and introduce people to your culture. You know, Tom? Pinto beans, right? Cornbread, right? From North Carolina. I'm North Carolina, Tom. And so just sharing a little bit of who we are and where we came from and why I'm wearing this shirt this morning. Now, before I do the sermon this morning, I'm going to share with you, really, the truth of the matter is I am a traveling salesman. And I brought my suitcase with me this morning, and I hope it's not a shock to you, but I really am here to advertise about a trip and to see if I can make sure that everybody has signed up before I leave today and that you've got your ticket. And I think I have everything I need in here. If I can just find my glasses, which are supposed to be there. But at any rate, we'll make it happen, and I'll get you registered for this trip today if I can. It's a trip that Jesus tells us about in John chapter 3 and verse 3, if you will, please. And then he advertises the trip in John chapter 14 when he says, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. You know that scripture? Isn't that a blessed scripture? I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And he says, you know what? I want you to be where I'm going. And he said, now I'm going to make preparations for you. Now, in my North Carolina builder's mind, I saw, as it were, him having a bag of carpenter's tools and some saws and some hammers and some two-by-fours, which are costing entirely too much these days, $10 for a two-by-four, I'm told. That's the way I thought. Have you ever pictured heaven? I dare you to sit and think about the architecture of heaven for 5 minutes, concentrate on it, and see if you put a window or a door or an air conditioner or carpet or towel, and you'll see how far we miss how human we are. We can't even conceive. You see, the analogies that are pictured in the Bible are just attempts to get to our human mind to help us begin to understand. But Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place, but that's not the best part. He said, and if I go away, what? I will come again. That where I am, what? You may be also. Now he said, but you need a ticket. You need a ticket for this trip. And the ticket you need for this trip is that you must be born again. You must be born again. Just so you understand, July 16th, coming, will be the second anniversary of me laying on a surgery table at University of Virginia and having pancreatic cancer surgery. You know anybody that's had pancreatic cancer surgery? If you do, you probably know somebody's died. Some say only 5% are alive in 3 years. I'm in my second year, finishing up just in a few weeks. By God's grace, my cancer was discovered in stage one. Doctors are amazed. They just cannot believe it. My personal physician is a friend, and every time we talk, he said, it's God, Pastor Bear. It was just God. The Lord carried me through it with wonderful surgeon and medical teams, chemotherapy, my sister who's here, complication, and 7 rounds of chemo I complicated, built a bubble this big literally in my abdomen that they didn't know what it was, and they said, we have to stop the chemo. And the doctor said, it's a natural thing, let nature take care of it. And they stopped chemo, and it completely dissolved, so we still don't know what that was. But so far, every CAT scan is showing me clear by the grace of God. Hallelujah. And so Layla and I, this is part of my sermon. It's not adding to it, won't take longer. I don't like vacations. My Tar Heel nature is, I get out of bed, I've got a project, I go to bed, I've already got plans for tomorrow. And vacations are dull and boring to me. I just am at my wit's end with the vacation. So Layla came to me one day when I was a pastor, and she said, I have an idea. She said, why don't we think of somewhere we've never been and go there, take a break, and we will visit pastors' families while we're there. And we started this some perhaps 15 years ago or so, and we've been all over the United States and in foreign countries, and we like call a pastor like Pastor Asbury and say, we want to meet you. We want the wife present. We want the children present. High moment for us last night with three teenage boys being present and us just talking to them about life. And I try and make sure that children are included. And I tell them, if you have children at home, bring them. And typically we pay for the meal. Now, Pastor Asbury is a very generous person, and when we've met, he paid for the meal, and that's not normal. We raise funds, and we travel, and we minister to people, and we give gifts to pastoral families. And we've had such blessed encounters in this journey that we're making, and now we have people who are encouraging us, and even administrative bishops who are asking us to come and visit their state, because we don't have titles, we don't have positions, we can't promote people, we can't demote people, we can't move them from church to church. All we can do is meet with them and listen and encourage them and perhaps offer some counsel. Now, in all of that, and as we've traveled, Kenyan Charismatic, Pentecostal Holiness Assembly of God, Independent, yes, Baptist. I was a guest professor at Southern in North Carolina at Wake Forest, and that opened the door to the Baptist Church. When Baptist churches hear that I was a guest professor there, they're kind of difficult, and they're willing for me to speak to them. And so we've been in a number of Baptist churches in both Southern and Independent. And literally weeks ago, with listening to sermons and listening to what's going on in this country, I said to myself, the next time that I have an opportunity to preach, I'm going to talk about being born again. Now, my voice is not back to normal from my cancer surgery yet, but if you will allow me, and with Layla's help, you're welcome to join me as we sing this song, and then I'll share the message. You may think it's foolish what I'm going to say. Born again, there's really been a change in me. Born again, just like Jesus said. Born again, and all because of Calvary. I'm glad, so glad that I've been born again. You may think it's foolish what I'm gonna say. Sorry, Layla. One day, right? One day I pray, Jesus, take my sin away. And that's when I was born again. Born again, there's really been a change in me. Born again, just like Jesus said. Born again, and all because of Calvary. I'm glad, so glad that I've been born again. I'm glad, so glad that I've been born again. And I'm glad for that. Now, I understand 12 of you affirmed publicly this morning. What a beautiful moment. What a beautiful moment. Pastor Todd was hopeful for 7, and you got bonus this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm so happy for you. Happy for you as a church. And so all 12 of you publicly said, I'm born again. And I'm going to assume that may be true of everybody here this morning. But if you're going to allow me, I'm still going to talk about what it means, because it's a subject that's being neglected these days. And folks are thinking that if they're good and charitable, you know, some of the richest people in the world today have no acknowledgement of Jesus Christ, but they're generous. There are people who will deny Christ that are literally giving hundreds of millions of dollars to charity, even billions. And they think that's salvific. They think that if there is any goodness in the future, it'll come to them because they're charitable. And we're probably of the level of society, the classification that most of us have heard the expression. I'm not sure the Queen of England and her royalty, but in our level of living, we hear people say they'd give you the shirt off their back. Give you the shirt off their back. That's so charitable. And I would say to you, your pastor is just one of the most generous people I know. He is amazing to me. But let me share with you that being generous is not salvific. Being servant-hearted is not salvific. That means it won't save you. Going out and doing good, taking food to your neighbors, won't save you. Thank you for what you're doing. That's wonderful and awesome. And Jesus said, if you're going to be a Christian, you ought to be generous to the poor. That's, if you go, 1 year I spent the whole year going through the Bible and looking at how many times Jesus talked about, or the Word of God talks about, feeding the poor, taking care of the poor, taking care of the orphan, taking care of the widow. I mean, it saturates the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. It's there. And thank you for that. But that does not save you. John 3:3, Jesus said, you must know, he says to Nicodemus, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You just can't. You must be born again, Jesus said. Now, the backdrop of the scripture from Luke chapter 15 and beginning with verse 11, the backdrop of this is that Jesus has gone to a Pharisee's house. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees were rulers in Israel. The Sadducees did not believe in a resurrection, and they had their side. The Pharisees did believe in the resurrection. The Sadducees did not believe in angels. They didn't believe in miracles. And the Pharisees did. Now, actually, if you go to Israel today, about one-third of Israel is agnostic or atheist. I've been to Israel. I have a very close Jewish friend in Israel who is Jewish. And here's what he tells me. Even today, people in Israel who are atheists, if they die, they have a rabbi do their funeral. All Jews have a rabbi at their funeral. Isn't that something? So the Sadducees, though they didn't believe in miracles, didn't believe in a resurrection, they claimed there's God. You got to obey. So they were scholarly in the law. And the Pharisees were scholarly in the law. The Sadducees were like royalty. They're not the priests now. They're like royalty. They have royal lineage, and they're out there and well-connected to Rome. The Pharisees are people who have become wealthy, most of them, and powerful, and are well-educated. Both of them are well-educated, and both of them are what we would call Philadelphia lawyers. They're really the sharpest lawyers in town. Now, what we have to adjust in our mind, we think of the executive, legislative, and judicial system of our government, but the high priest was all of that. The high priest was over everything. I mean, he ruled over the law, he ruled over the courts, he had the power of life and death, and Rome let him, as long as he stayed within his confines, Rome let him. In fact, you may or may not hear a sermon sometime, and somebody will say, when Rome conquered Israel or conquered Jews, actually, there's never been a treaty between the Jews and Rome, not till this day. They did destroy the city, but there was no treaty signed, no agreement. And Rome found that the Jews were a contentious people. Out of all the countries they conquered, they found the Jews were a difficult people. And they let them just kind of rule themselves and have their high priest so long as they didn't interfere with Rome and paid taxes to Rome. So the high priest is responsible for the taxes. He's responsible for the law. He's responsible for everything. And you have to keep that in your mind. Now, the Levites are the priesthood. The Sadducees are connected with the government. And the Pharisees, they're lawyers too, and they help to rule the people. So it's a very complicated system. And Jesus goes to a Pharisee's house. Well, the typical Jewish person despised the Pharisees. The Pharisees, if you've ever like seen a drama or something, they'd be dressed in their robes and have on their hat, and they would have a little box in the middle of their forehead that'd be about 1 inch square and belted around their forehead, and they would have people with microscopes write Old Testament scriptures and pack them inside this little box, and it would be standing out from their forehead, and they would come out of the door of their home. And when they did, they didn't come out alone. They would send like servants ahead of them with long poles, 6 or 8 feet long, because poor people would lay at the door of rich people. And so you're coming out and you're a Pharisee and you're a holier than thou person and you're in your sanctimonious robes. You would have servants who would come out in front of you and use long poles and prod and make people get back from you because you couldn't touch them. If you were, you were unclean. If they even touched your garments, you were unclean. And so imagine how much the common people would have despised the Pharisees. And Jesus goes to a Pharisee's house. And can you imagine the consternation? Can you imagine the confusion it was causing? And he's sitting and they're saying, you're meeting with a Pharisee? And so he talks about things that are eternal in this Pharisee's house. And then chapter 15 comes and he starts talking about, if you had 100 sheep and one was lost, what would you do? You'd secure 99, go find it. And then he comes down to passage beginning with verse 11. And he says, now, a certain man had 2 sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. Now, imagine, he's telling this in the Pharisee's house. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal, I mean wasteful, sinful living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed the swine. Uh-oh, hold on. What is it? Jews don't eat swine. They don't raise swine. They don't touch swine. Not kosher, unclean. And here Jesus is saying that a Jewish royal blood, rich man, has son, has left his father, gone to a foreign country, and that he is actually going to work with the swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. No one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf here and kill it. And let us eat and be merry, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. I just want to make three simple points to you as I finish this sermon. Lost in a foreign country. Lost in a foreign country. The scripture says that he left his father with his inheritance in verse 14 and went to a foreign country. I want to say to you, you're in a foreign country. This is not your natural habitat. This is not the best that God has planned for you. And the world around you, Jesus said, is unfriendly to you. Now, I don't think we can rewrite scripture, but Jesus said that there is a way that leads to righteousness. There is a gate that enters in to heaven. And he said, most people are not going to go through that gate. Few are going to go through. He also said some things to you that you should be aware of. He said, if you love me, you'll be persecuted. You know, we like to make it soft and easy for people and tell them it's going to be so easy serving Jesus. Actually, the first few weeks of being a Christian were a whole lot tougher than being a sinner. For me, first few weeks were awful. Not that I didn't have joy, but my instincts to sin wanted to show up. Now, you may have been better than me, but I had something in my life at age 14 that was not drugs or anything like that, but it was something that I was doing that I knew was not right. And after I gave my heart to Jesus, it just kept coming to my mind, and then I'd be attracted to it. And I finally just numbered it 33, because I figured I'd ask God at least 33 times to forgive me. And I hadn't been able to just kind of climb across that impasse, that obstacle. And so I would just simply say, God, number 33 again. I need help for number 33. It took some time for me to conquer that in my life. And then you have the friendship situation. You're in a foreign country, and you've turned toward the Lord, but you have people that used to be friends, and you didn't dislike them when you became a Christian, but you can't do with them what you used to do. And you don't want to be a preacher of judgment against them all the time and say, you're going to hell. No, you don't want to do that. But at the same time, you can't go where you used to go. You can't do what you used to do. And you're in a foreign country. Now, if you're in that foreign country and you get pulled in by the devil, like a young man, 23 or so, that I personally know, who just week before last, a drug pusher who was selling him his drugs said to him, you're going to die if you don't get out now. And it scared him so bad because he'd been raised in church. I'd seen that young man in Sunday school. And he went to a drug rehab center, and they tested him, and they shook their heads, and they said, you have every known drug we test in your system. How are you alive? You should be dead. Yes, heroin. Yes, methamphetamines. Yes, fentanyl. Yes, yes. You have all of them in your system. He told me this week that he'd been paying $150 per day for his drug fixes. In the devil's camp in a foreign country, he drags people down and they don't even know they're being drugged down. And they read self-help books and they go to counselors and they watch self-help therapy sessions and they take medicines thinking that it's going to bring them out. And truthfully, honestly, some people can go to AA and stop drinking. Some people can take some medicine or go to a counselor and stop some bad habits. But it does not save your soul. The second thing that I would say to you is, in that foreign country, you can get pretty miserable and desperate for help. Now, it may be, and I have to say this in fairness to you as a child of God, it may be that in this foreign country of this world that we're surrounded, and I wrote an article this week and published it, and I didn't know how it was going to go over, but I am so sick and tired of being pushed. I'm tired of being called racist. I'm tired of being told I'm not woke. I'm sick and tired of it. Now, Sir Tom, I'm picking on you from Carolina. Are you from Carolina? Wherever you're from, if you're from Carolina, we call Tar Heels because there was a battle back in time and the Tar Heels didn't run. The North Carolinians didn't run. And the others said, well, the reason why they stayed in there fighting when we all ran was because they had tar from down East Carolina on their heels and they couldn't get loose. And there's just enough Tar Heel in me. I've been pushed for enough. And I don't like it when people are trying to take away from me my right to serve the Lord. I don't like it when people are telling me these days that if I'm not woke, if I'm not going to agree with all the anachronisms of the world and all the things you see and all, if I'm not, that I'm not in the groove. I'm not trying to be in the groove, are you? I'm trying to serve the Lord. And I'm going to take my justice from the Bible. I'm on the side of justice in the Bible. And I'm on the side of helping every person that I can help, whoever that is. And so I want you to understand that there are going to be frustrating moments in your life, and unless you look to the Lord, that's what we've got to come back to you this morning in this message over and over again. Unless you do, you're going to be buffeted. And again, growing up in North Carolina, anybody ever remember an old Maytag washing machine with the two ringers that would roll, and if your hand got caught in it, you had to stop the machine and pop something loose to lift it up and get your hand back out, and all, and they just wring the clothes out? You know, the world would like to run you through that machine and just wring you out. And you've got to say, I'm not going to allow it. I am not. I'm sticking my feet down. I'm going to stand my ground. And I am not going to be part of the world. I am not going to go feed the swine. I am not going to go eat with the hogs. I am not going to be part of the devil's system. And I'm not going to let people beat me down because I don't do the things that they do and say the things that they say and go the places that they go. I don't. And I'll just tell you from a pulpit. I'm 76 years old. I don't know what alcohol tastes like. I don't have to know. Somebody says, will you go to hell if you drink alcohol? I said, I don't know, but I'd go to heaven without drinking alcohol. I'm just fine. Thank you very much, you know. I mean, come on. Let's get over this stuff of being beat up on folks. It is an ungodly world. Do you doubt that? Are you unclear about that? You need to be clear that outside the church doors in the world out there, it is an ungodly world. And it's a foreign world. But we are a people that we recognize from John 3:3 that Jesus said, you must be born again. You must be born again. And so the way home is through the cross. The way home is through Jesus. The blood is still a part of the Bible. Some churches have taken it out of their hymn books. They've taken it out of their literature. They've tried to erase it down and make Jesus social do good. We were out in Oregon, where was it? I've forgotten now. Layla and I traveling somewhere. Maine, it was Maine, yes, last fall. And there's a church up in Maine that has the rainbow on the front of the door. On the front of the church, big, bigger than a church sign. Got the rainbow that you can be gay, lesbian, transgender, whatever else, and you're just fine with God. God wants you to be who you are. But I want to tell you, your business is not to be trying to advertise the world's values. As a people of God, our challenge is, our business is to say, ye must be born again. The way home. If you want to go on the trip, if you want to go to heaven, you got to purchase the ticket. And the ticket was paid for by Jesus. The ticket is by Jesus. His blood shed paid for the ticket. Many years ago, I read a story about a man who got on a ship to come to America. It is said that he was poor. He saved up money. He paid for the ticket. He got on the ship. But they could never find him in the place where they served the food at food time. Finally, one day, somebody went looking for him. And they found him down in the bowels of the ship. And when he'd come aboard, he had stored a block of cheese. And he would go down and chip off the cheese. And they said, "What are you doing? What are you doing?" He said, "I couldn't afford anything except my ticket, and I brought food, and I'm just eating the cheese and drinking water." And they said, "You fool, did you not understand that when you paid for the ticket, you paid for the food, you paid for the ride? You can eat the cafeteria. You can eat at the Lord's table. You can eat at the table of the Lord and sit with the saints and be part of the kingdom. You don't have to be in the bottom of the ship. Jesus paid the price. He paid the price. But there's something that's required of us, and it's that's so difficult. We have to admit we're sinners. We have to admit and say to God, God, I am a sinner. I am clay. I am flawed because my father Adam messed up. And I'm not blaming it on Eve. I'm blaming it on my father Adam. He messed up, and because he messed up, sin entered the world. My race is cursed. People say sometimes, "I don't know why Aunt so-and-so died. She was such a wonderful saint. I don't know why that, you know, just this week, one of our wonderful, wonderful Church of God pastors of a large church in Florida, tremendous and talented man, in the prime of his years, went walking and just fell dead. I think Thursday or Friday of this week. So the funeral's not even been had yet." And people say, "Why? Why? Because we're a flawed world. Why, Pastor Barry, you're pastoring a church. Why'd you have cancer?" Because there's sin in the world. Because there's our bodies are doomed to die. Because this body's going to go to a grave at some point in time. Why? Why? Don't, no, it's not that. That's not the answer. The answer is you're alive now. The answer is you have a choice. The answer is you make a decision. The answer is you choose what you're going to do with your heart and with your soul, with your life. And people say, "It's so hard." And I say, "Hey, I've got an idea. I know where there's a bank that we can rob." Not Pastor Asbury's, but, you know, "I know where there's a bank we can rob, and I figured out we can get away with it clean. They'll never catch us. I'm a criminologist." That's true. I'm from PhD in criminology, part of my background. I've taught police science and criminologists, and all that's part of my life, and I know how to do this, and I figured it out, and they'll never catch us. We're going to get away with millions of dollars. And I said, "Will you help me?" And they said, "What? Are you kidding? You're a preacher? You're asking me to help you rob a bank?" And I said, "Yeah, will you do it? Come on. I mean, we can do this, and we can go move down the Caribbean. We can live like kings." And they said, "Oh, I would never do that, Pastor Barry." I said, "What? You made a decision. Well, then, why don't you choose to quit cigarettes? Why don't you choose to go to church?" You see, we make decisions. People, "Well, I'm just not going to commit to anything. I'm not." Okay, take out your driver's license and tear it up. Go ahead, I'm waiting on you. I got a pocket knife. We'll just cut it up right here in front of you. Because you signed that you would obey the laws of North of Virginia with that driver's license. Are you married? You promised to take care of your wife and children. We have an adopted child. The judge looked at us and he said, "Do you understand? You are taking property of the Commonwealth of Virginia and you are accountable to the Commonwealth from this day forward." You know what the judge said to us? With our little boy about a year old that we'd gotten when he was 3 days old, he said, "You must understand that it will be more difficult for you to disinherit this child than your natural born children." We signed that we would take property of the Commonwealth of Virginia. What'd you sign for? "Oh, you got a loan at the bank? I bet you signed it. You got a car loan? I bet you signed it. I bet you didn't say, 'Well, I'm not going to sign it. I'm going to go out here in the street and I'm going to pay some John Henry out here that I don't know to come in and sign that because I don't want to be obligated to this loan.' I want to know. You made a decision. You see, I want to rest that with you. You made a decision. And that's what the Lord expects you to do. He expects you to make a decision and say, I'm a sinner. I need the blood of Jesus Christ. I confess my sins. I confess my, God help us. We wouldn't live long enough to confess all of our sins, would we? Come on. Come on. I mean, you know, come on. When I was about 8 years old, I had a wart on my finger, a hand here, I think it's right there. And I was told that if I would steal a dish rag from an old woman, that that wart would go away. Now, I stole that dish rag, and the wart went away, whether it's that or not. And I never got to apologize. I even went back years later, and she's dead. How am I going to correct that? Will you help me? You start listing your sins, you're not going to live long enough. You better just packaging them up and bundling them up and say, God, I am a flawed human being. I'm messed up. And I confess to you, I need a Savior. Oh, hear the cry of that prodigal. He says, I'm going home. I'll be a servant in my father's house. I'll tell him I'm not worthy. You don't have to do anything special for me. Just let me eat, live in the servant's quarters. But the Father, see the Father, see the grace of the Father. He sees his Son. This is my take. This is my take. Can I back up? I'm going to finish the minute. An adopted son was a student at Lee University. He went on a mission trip and came up with some kind of infection that affected his brain. His brain was swelling, and they couldn't seem to solve it at the hospital in Cleveland, Tennessee. And they were getting ready to airlift him. I left Charlottesville, Virginia, and I will not tell you how fast I drove. And I got to Cleveland, Tennessee, and backed up to the hospital, and I said, put my son in my car. Put him in my car. And at my insistence, they put my fevered son in our car, and we patted him in, covered him up, and I drove back to Virginia with doctors that I knew and medical staff waiting at the University of Virginia. I drove furiously and got him to the hospital, and they were able to save his life because he had a bacterial infection that they believe was from swimming in waters, from archaic water off of waterfalls, an amoeba thousands of years old that he swallowed came alive and infected his body. The thought of losing that son drove me passionately to find help. God, to find you, sent his son. God sent his son to redeem you. Not so you could have all these nice cars in the parking lot. That doesn't offend God. He's happy for you to have nice things. But he did it so that you could be born again. And so that when Jesus comes, you'll be stamped with that insignia, born again. You confessed your sins. You repented. You believed upon Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. And you're destined to spend eternity with our Lord. Is that good news, folks? Born again. Born again. Hallelujah. I celebrate that. I want you to know that. Pastor Asbury did such a wonderful job with you in prayer time last time. I'm going to ask him if he will come and if he will engage us in a prayer time. And if you're not, if you've never, listen, if you don't know when it happened, if you just kind of like made your journey kind of evolutionarily, you know, when you just kind of went to church and all, but you can't say time and place or something, maybe today you say, God, before I leave here today, I want this day to be a signal day in my life of saying to you, punch my ticket
I want to confess to you, and I want you to say to me, as it were, that I would hear heaven saying, you're born again, child of God, welcome home. Pastor, will you take it and lead us in prayer?
You must be born again. You must. There's no exception. You must be born again. If you're here today, why don't we all just stand together? If you're here today, or maybe you're watching on live stream, you must be born again. You must. You must be born again. It's a necessity. There's no other way. Sometimes we can be the religious person, the Pharisee. We can be the Sadducee. We've put on the act. We show up at church. We do good things, as our brother was sharing. But never had a conversion, really, inside, where you were born again of the Spirit of God. It matters not what age you are. You can be a young person. You can be middle-aged. You can be an older person. And you can still be born again. Nicodemus asked a question. How am I going to be able to be born again? How can you enter back into your mother's womb? Jesus said, listen, this is not how you're born again. It's not a physical birth. This is a spiritual birth. And the Holy Spirit comes in like the wind. And we don't know which direction he's going to come from, but we know he's come. We know he's done something when he's there. And then he's gone. Think about when we're born again, he not only comes and does something in us, he abides in us now. So he changes us from the inside out, and he starts to live inside our hearts. If you've never had a born again experience, you must be born again. You must surrender it all. You must give it all over to Jesus. Confess that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. We're going to have a word of prayer after we pray, or as I'm praying. If you want to come and have prayer, if you need prayer, if you want to be born again, if you want to rededicate, you have a need of whatever it may be, Pastor Bear's here. Sister Layla, will you come? Melissa, will you come? Other pastors, Pastor Jeff, Sister Linda, different ones. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the word today that we've received. We thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit that's at work. We live in a foreign land. We're passing through. There are some maybe today that's still living in that foreign place, in that pit, eating with the swine, not only feeding them, but eating with them. Lord, let them come to their senses today, as the prodigal son did. Let them come to the realization, it was better in my father's house. I'm going to arise and I'm going to go back to my father. Pray, Lord, that anybody, maybe in any condition, that needs to get things right with you, because we believe, Lord, that you are coming soon. We believe that you have gone to prepare that place for us, and that promise that you've made that you will come back again and receive us unto yourself, that where you are, we may be also. We're so much closer today than we were even yesterday. We must be ready. We must be born again. Help us, Lord. Every single person, God, that we would all know within our hearts with confidence, with assurance to know that our name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. I pray, Lord, for every person that's here, every person that's watching and will watch throughout the week or the upcoming days and months or whatever time that they tune in, that you would turn their lives around and turn them to you. Save their souls, Lord. And we thank you for salvation. In Jesus' name. If you have a prayer need for anything, come. We want to pray with you. God's able to do it. As we sing, any need that you have, desperate for God to move, maybe it's a child that you have, maybe it's a loved one that's prodigal, that's gone out, that's doing things, living a wasteful life, and you just want somebody to pray with you as parents or grandparents and say, will you join with me? Will you just agree with me for their salvation? Come. We'll pray for you. Pray for your needs. Praise God. If you've been born again, the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. Amen. Redeemed means we've been purchased. We've been purchased by Him, by the blood. And say so. not just here amongst other believers, but go out there and say so. Tell them what the Lord's done for you. Continue to share a testimony. Let them know what the Lord's done in your life. Some people may not come in the doors, but we have the doors we've got to go out. And when we go out, go share the good news. Wherever you are, whether it's at work or school or on the soccer field or you name it, Walmart, Target, right? We won't leave Target out. Target, wherever you go, or wherever the Lord opens the door, walk in that door and share about Jesus. Amen. He's been good. Been good to me. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Bear. Thank you, Layla. Let's give them a hand of appreciation and just let them know. We do love them and appreciate them and so thankful for them to be here today. We were talking last night right before before they left our home. Sister Layla, she does a spiritual gifts assessment class. And we're talking about maybe having her come. And it's like a weekend thing. So it's a Friday evening, Saturday morning, Sunday afternoon. And you can come in and she will help. And she's certified in this to do gifts assessment. And I think it would be a wonderful thing for our church to do, to be able to determine what your spiritual gifts are and how to assess those. And we're going to talk some more about that and plan. And we're going to have them back again. Would y'all like to have them back again? Yeah. You know, for a long time, you know, they were pastoring in Charlottesville. I would love for them to come down. But I know how difficult it is to leave from your responsibilities as a pastor. But now they're not doing it. So we'll just reel them in more often, right? And have them come and be with us as much as they can. So continue to pray for them and their travels, and as they go, that God will keep them safe, and that He will open the doors of to many pastors and their wives or spouse, that when they go to them, that they'll be able to share a word of encouragement, somebody that maybe is going through a difficult time, that God would point them and direct them directly to the persons that they need to go to. Someone that's maybe willing, ready to give up and quit. Maybe somebody that's going through a difficult time, that they'd be able to come in and by God's love through them and flowing through them, that they would be able to share and help them to get back on track and to keep moving forward until we finish and cross the finish line. Amen? And that's what we should be doing. So we're going to pray for them. We're going to pray that God just continues to bless them and uses them. And I want to make you aware, ladies are having a meeting tomorrow evening at what time? 6 o'clock. So I see several ladies in this group here. And you all are welcome to come and be a part of the women's ministry. This is something they're starting back up. We haven't had it in quite a while with COVID-19. But please come. And all you mamas, next week's Mother's Day, okay? Next Sunday's Mother's Day. You need to get all your kids and your grandkids and your neighbor's kids and everybody else's kids and bring them with you, right? And we want to see the Lord move on Mother's Day. And I know God can and will. I've seen things happen on Mother's Day that God moved in people's lives. And so you go and invite them. And I think we may have some kind of prizes. Do we have prizes? Is there something going on? Hello? We'll find out. We'll let you know. I think there's something about the people who have the most kids or something. I don't know. But we'll let you know. But even if that, I mean, if there's no prize to be given here, there is a prize to receive up there. Amen? So whether you get something here or not, there's a reward waiting for us up there. So invite everybody you can. Get your families in and bring them in. Amen? Amen. God bless you all. We love you. We're going to pray for Pastor Bear and Layla. So if you will, let's just stretch your hands this way toward them. And we want to pray for them and that God just continues to bless them and use them. Father, we thank you for our pastor and his wife, our pastors, Pastor Bear and Layla. God, that's been so instrumental in our lives and taught us so many things, and things practically, things spiritually, things that has helped us to grow and help prepare us for this ministry here. Helps us to see through a different set of lenses than what we used to see. And opened our eyes more and more. Took us into deeper places with you, Lord. God, I thank you for them. And I pray your blessings upon them and their family, their children and their grandchildren, their great-grandkids. I pray, Lord, that you would bless them, give them favor. Lord, as they travel, wherever they go, wherever you send them, I pray, Lord, that the doors open widely before them and that you would go in before them and your presence would be there in such a powerful way. Lord, for that pastor who's going and contemplating, giving up and quitting, maybe the one that's discouraged and depressed, maybe that wife who has just had enough, Lord, that they'd be able to go and speak life into that ministry. Go and to be able to share from their experiences, but not only their experiences, but the love that flows through them, your love flowing through them, to help somebody along the way to continue to do the work, continue to move forward. Bless them. Keep them safe. Help them to continue to get good reports, health reports. Help them both, Lord, with all the things that they're doing and the things that they move forward. Your blessings. Abundant blessings, God. Richly, abundantly bless them and give them favor. And we ask this in Jesus' name. And we give honor and glory to you for everything. And we bless this people. We bless this congregation. We bless those that are watching. And we pray, Lord, for your blessings and your favor to be upon all. God, that wherever we all go, Lord, and that the doors will open before all of us widely, that we may be a witness of you. That we continue to see your love and your grace and your mercy to be extended to those who are lost, to be saved, to be born again. And Father, we pray, Lord, that you would just continue to bless this church. Thank you for these that have joined today. Bless them. And thank you, Lord, for those that's going to be joining. And thank you, Lord, for new ones that continue to come in. And we just thank you, God, for everything. We give you praise in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless y'all. Have a wonderful day. Have a wonderful week. And we love you all. God bless you.